Very good morning, church, and a blessed Thanksgiving week. What a great time for us to just pause from our busy schedule and just reflect on the goodness of God and just give Him thanks for all that He is and all that He has done for us. So, church, let's take this moment to focus on our triune God, on His attributes, on His greatness, as we prepare ourselves for a time of singing and listening to His words. And it's our prayer that He will be exalted in our midst, in our lives, in our homes this morning. Shall we just take this time to pray, prepare our hearts. Father, we just want to say thank You so much for Your love and Your grace. We thank You for waking us up and for the gift of this new day. We thank You because it's even more refreshing because of Your grace, Your mercy that overflows in our lives. We thank You for enabling us to experience the joy, the peace despite of the unwanted circumstances, difficult, challenging circumstances in our lives. Even words cannot express how thankful we are. Our mind cannot even comprehend the experience that we go through because of You, O God. And this morning as a church, we come to Your throne of grace through Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, we come with a heart of thanks and gratitude for all that You are and all that You have done for us. We thank You because we are so wretched, sinful, filthy, and yet You love us so much that You send Your only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our place, to take the curse upon Himself, so that today we might become the righteousness of God, acceptable into Your presence. We thank You so much, O God. Hallelujah. We thank You. We pray that You, our triune God, be exalted and glorified in our midst this morning. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shall we sing this beautiful song? This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
Grace, yes it is. This is unfailing love.
your goodness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank you, God, for setting us free. Oh, glory. This is amazing grace. Amazing grace, how sweet the song that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did the grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been saved. Unending love. We thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you for your love, for your unconditional love. Because it is not because of our merit or anything that we have done to achieve it, but it is purely because of your love and your grace. We thank you, O God. Hallelujah. We thank you. Because we have been clothed with the righteousness of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is no longer I, but it is Christ who lives in us. We thank you. It's yet not I, but through Christ, we can do all things. Through Christ who strengthens us.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? Can there be any greater gift than this? He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoice, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me through the deepest valley. He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. I know I am forgiven.
The future show.
The future show.
Yes, the prize is
the
paid.
The prize it has been paid.
Yes.
For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow.
Of fact that we are able to sing this song this truth regardless of the circumstances around us. Hallelujah. We thank you for this great hope we have in Christ Jesus. This morning we worship you for who you are. Hallelujah. In Revelation 5:11 onwards, then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, and 10,000 times 10,000. And they encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they were saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. And that is what exactly we want to do this morning. Christ at the center. We encircling Christ who is seated at the throne together with the elders and the angels. Hallelujah. You are the focus. You are the reason. You are our everything, oh God, this morning. And we worship you. Yes, you are worthy to receive all the power, glory, and honor. Hallelujah. Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark ones stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? Yes. Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us? And does Jesus, our Messiah, holds forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Let's sing it out together. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to
throne, the Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave from every people and tribe, every nation and tongue. He has made us a kingdom of priests to God, to reign with the Son. He's the Word.
Triune presence here in our midst. We thank you that you take pleasure and you inhabit in the praises of your children. We thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Be exalted and glorified in our midst, now and always. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Once again, a very good morning and welcome to our worship service this morning. We thank the music team for leading us in that time of worship through singing and those wonderful songs that we sang, truly exalting the greatness of our God. This morning, I would like to read wedding bands, and it is my pleasure to publish the bands for the intended wedding of Mark Thiel, son of Sydney and Ann Thiel, member of Crossroad Church, Bangalore, with Pranita Dorai, daughter of late Mr. Chinna Dorai and Mrs. Sarla Dorai, member of Garden City, AG Church. This wedding is to take place on December the 20th, 2020. If anyone has any just cause why these two people may not be lawfully united in marriage according to Christian traditions, let that person declare it to the pastor of the Crossroad Church in writing. This is the first bands. Let's pray. We'll pray for Mark and Pranita, as well as pray for our church, have a pastoral prayer. So let's look to the Lord in a word of prayer. God, our Father in heaven, we thank you once again as we are gathered together in our different places and watching the service online, and yet we recognize that you are present because we have approached your throne through our Lord Jesus Christ. And even though some of us are in different places, yet we are glad for this opportunity to worship together. Our Father, we thank you that you have faithfully watched over our lives as we even come to the end of a month and even close to the end of a year. We thank you for your faithfulness in leading us through all these months with the pandemic situation and various other times that maybe there were ups and there were downs in the year that has gone by. Father, we also pray that if it be your will, that there would be a vaccine produced soon, or you would take away this virus from our midst, that you would do it. And we ask that you will continue to strengthen us and enable us to keep trusting you in all situations of life. Father, we pray for the members of Crossroad Church. We pray for those that are unwell in our midst, and we ask that you would have your hand of mercy upon them. And even as some of us wait for a physical healing, enable us to keep looking to you and to keep trusting in you in the situation that you have placed us. We pray for those that are in different situations and probably even this morning are looking for a word of encouragement, a word of hope, a word of guidance maybe, that you would speak to us and give us the wisdom that we need, the encouragement that we need, the hope that we need from the Word of God. We pray that you guide our steps, as there are some in our midst that are looking to get married and some that are looking to change jobs and have different situations take place. We want to thank you and we want to continue looking to you for wisdom and for guidance. We uphold Mark and Pranita as they prepare for their wedding, and we pray that you will go before them, you will prepare their hearts, and you will give them all favor and all wisdom that they need as they prepare for their big day on December 20th. Father, we also pray for Pastor Subhash and Sister Alice as they are traveling back, and we ask that you would give them safety and much needed rest and comfort and encouragement from the time that they have been able to spend together with their family. And we look forward to their continued ministry here with us at Crossroad Church. We pray that you will enable us to have a good end of this month, as well as prepare for December and our Christmas celebrations and outreach. And may all these things go well. We also pray that your hand would be upon our government, both at the center and at the state, and so many situations that are taking place in our country right now. Father, we ask that your peace would prevail upon this land, and you will give wisdom to the ruling people, that they would be able to rule wisely and would be able to take care of the needs of a multitude of different people. And so we thank you. We pray that you bless our time as we spend in the Word of God this morning, and bless the preacher as he brings your word to us. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I would like to invite Brother Samuel Singapogu to bring us the Word of God this morning. Brother Samuel, or he's also known as Dr. Samuel, he does not really require too much introduction. Many of us know him. He is a life group leader at our church on Sunday afternoons, and he is very involved in the ministry, both in Hyderabad and here in Bangalore, and we really look forward to hearing the Word of God from him. So, welcome, Brother Samuel.
Greetings in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Such a great joy, blessing to be with you this morning in the meditation, study, and reflection of the Holy Word of God. If you have your Bibles, would you please turn to Mark chapter 10, and we'll be looking at verses 17 through 22. Mark chapter 10 from verse 17 to 22. Such a joy to have this great group of singers and musicians who have ignited our hearts in love for the Lord and reverence, and a wonderful team of media and tech that makes it available for us online. Before we read our passage and ask the Lord for help, I am aware that we are going through very troubled times. Because of the pandemic, the coronavirus, we feel its effect individually, locally, nationally, and internationally. And as I was preparing for this message, I realized that what I was going to say has very little immediate blessing and help in these difficult times, because we will be talking about eternal things. So my prayer has been that the Lord would help us transcend these present times and reach into eternity. As Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, These light momentary afflictions are preparing for us an eternal weight of glory. So would you join me in prayer to ask the Lord to awaken our hearts to the realities of eternity despite our difficult circumstances? The passage again is Mark chapter 10 from verse 17 to 22. And the Holy Word of God says, "And as he was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, 'Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?' And Jesus said to him, 'Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments: do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and mother.' And he said to him, 'Teacher, all these I have kept from my youth.' And Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, 'You lack one thing. Go, sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come follow me.' Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions." Let's ask the Lord for help. Loving Heavenly Father, we come to you asking that you may make this time profitable for eternal things. Father, I am weak and frail, and I feel a deep sense of unworthiness at this time. So I acknowledge my weakness, but I also acknowledge your strength and your power. And I fall at your feet to ask that you may somehow make this time eternally profitable for me, for everyone else. I ask this in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The full context for the passage that we just read is verses 17 to verse 31. But it was difficult for us to look at the whole passage in the time that we have, and also the kernel, the core of the truth is in verses 17 through 22 that get rippled into different ways from verse 23 to 31. And you'll notice that this passage that we just read is an interaction, a conversation between the Lord Jesus and a man that came up to him. This is unusual in the narrative of Mark, as we have been studying the book of Mark, and it's been a blessing to so many of us. But you'll notice that we've never seen this sort of thing in Mark. It's unusual. There's no miracle here. There's no feeding of the 5,000. There's no healing of the blind. No casting out demons. There is nothing miraculous on the external. And Mark usually doesn't talk to us about these sort of things. John, on the other hand, does talk to us about conversations. Nicodemus, the Samaritan woman, but Mark doesn't. And yet he does here. And what's also very interesting is, so does Matthew and so does Luke. So what makes a conversation that on the surface has nothing extravagant about it so important that Matthew and Mark and Luke all mention it? The conversation is started when a man comes up to Christ. And Mark sets up the context for us by saying Jesus was setting out on his journey. He's leaving the Judean region, going towards Jerusalem. And you can imagine a sunny day, dusty road, people following Christ, and here's a man who comes running. So we notice his eagerness, his desire, his keenness to have this conversation, that he's willing to come running to Christ. Mark also tells us that this man is a rich man. Verse 22, we see that he has great possessions. Luke mentions that to us, and so does Matthew. He's a rich man. Luke also tells us that he's young and a ruler. We kind of figured out the young part because he's running. But Luke tells us that he's also a ruler. Most probably, he was one among the three in the local synagogue that takes care of the affairs of the congregation. Proselytizing, managing the affairs, spiritual guidance, and also magisterial oversight. You'll notice in Matthew chapter 10 and verse 17, Christ talks about people who have authority in the synagogue to even invoke corporal punishment. Here's a man like that. He's a ruler. He's young and is rich. And he comes to Jesus. He kneels before him in public. When everyone's watching, here's a ruler of the local synagogue. Come, kneels before Christ. There's submission. Visible, overt, public submission. Humility. And the way he addresses Christ. Good teacher. Alfred Plummer, who was a 19th century scholar, tells us in his commentary on Luke that this is a very, very unusual address. There's absolutely no record that he could find of anyone in the Jewish circumstances using this kind of an address. Good teacher. He's being unusually polite. And he has a very important question, doesn't he? He says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? You notice his sight, vision is not on material things. He wants eternal life. He wants to be in the arms of his eternal Father forever. I say Father because he uses the word inherit, not obtain, not get, not receive. How do I inherit? Clearly, he thinks of himself as a son of Abraham, and he believes that eternal life is going to come to him as a son through inheritance. He's looking pretty good here, doesn't he? Good profile, a ruler, rich, young, humility, submission, sights on eternal things. You would expect that Jesus would give the same answer that he gave in chapter 8 that we saw on 18th of October, which was, follow me, take up your cross, deny yourself, follow me. Jesus already gave the answer to this question just a couple of chapters ago. And you would expect that Jesus would give the same response. Instead, verse 18, Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. So you'll notice the response of Christ is with a very, very perplexing, baffling question. Seems to be going off script here. Just give the usual response, Lord. Or why doesn't he just give the usual response we give? Believe. Christ also said that in Mark 1, repent and believe. Instead, Christ asks a question. Why do you call me good? Christ is worried about the way this man is addressing him. It's a why question. Like the other 338 questions that the Lord Jesus asks in the Gospels, the why questions of Christ usually try to strip away the external, cut deep into the heart of the man, and open up something. But we don't get to see that here. It is difficult at this point to understand why the Lord is asking this question. So let's just wait and see whether something gets uncovered in this man's heart for us to understand why Christ asked this question. And then Christ refers him to the commandments. These are the bottom half of the Ten Commandments, along with one command, do not defraud, which is from Deuteronomy 19. And Christ tells him, these are the commandments. Notice that Christ doesn't say, you follow these commandments and you will have eternal life. He just says, you know the commandments. To be sure, Christ does keep the commandments. He's perfectly righteous. And because we follow Christ and believe in him, his righteousness does come to us credited, imputed. But we, in our imperfect, sinful pursuit of the commandments, cannot attain righteousness. So again, perplexing. Why does Christ point this man to the commandments? And then we see this man's response in verse 20. And he said to him, Teacher, all these I have kept from my youth. What an incredible, remarkable individual. I don't know if there were many people in that time or in this time that can really say this. I've been careful since my youth. I've been pious. I've been diligent. What a remarkable individual. Eagerness to come to Christ. Humility, good manners, politeness. Putting his sight on eternal things. Keeping the commandments. Blameless. No one can say you did this wrong. He's been careful. He's been diligent. You know, I wonder if there were people in the crowd that might be thinking in their mind, Lord, finally a perfect disciple for you. He's not like Peter. He's not like those disciples who want the top seat. He's not like the disciples who get scared or don't have money to feed the 5,000. This guy would be perfect. Take him on your team. Make it 13 disciples. He will have enough money to feed people. He's not going to get scared in the boat. He's perfect as a disciple. Maybe even push Peter aside and give him the informal lead disciple role. As a side note also, did you notice that here's a man who has everything going for him? Age on his side, blameless externally, ruler in the synagogue. Everything works well for him, and yet he wants eternal life. Saint Augustine, in Confessions, which was his autobiography, he starts out with the statement, Thou hast made us for thyself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it finds its rest in thee. How true this is. You can have everything else in this world, but it will never satisfy the inner longing, the deepest desire of your life. And here's exhibit A, the rich young ruler. Exhibit B, incidentally, is Bob Marley. Yeah, that's right, Bob Marley. There was this interview that Marley did many, many years ago, and the interviewer goes, Are you a rich man? Marley, what do you mean rich? Interviewer, do you have a lot of possessions? Lots of money in the bank? Bob Marley, possessions make you rich? I don't have that type of richness. My richness is life forever. The inner longing of everyone in this world is eternal life. Let's see how Christ helps this man get eternal life. Verse 21. And Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, "You lack one thing." It's not so bad, one thing. "You lack one thing. Go, sell everything that you have, all that you have, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." Let's notice right away that Mark is very clear to tell us that Christ's response is in love. Jesus loved him. So whatever Christ is going to say now is immersed and showered with love. And Christ says, "You lack one thing." Just one thing. But the one thing is, you've got to go sell everything that you have, give it to the poor, and then you come follow me. This is also a little tricky to understand, because the moment you read the phrase, "You lack one thing," you're expecting Christ to say, "Here's the one thing." And then you see the words, and. Go this, and that, and. And so there are two ways that we could try to understand this passage. One would be to say that in Christ's mind, the one thing constitutes two parts. The first part is to get rid of all his possessions and to give it to the poor. And the second part would be to come follow Christ. But the more I thought about this passage, I have a different way to look at this. Because the way I think about it is, the one thing that he lacks is the one thing he will have at the end of this work that he's supposed to do. So think about it. He goes home. He makes an inventory of all the things that he possesses. He liquidates it, gives it to the poor. And even at that point, he's still lacking. He's giving stuff. You know, the only time he really gets something is when he comes and follows Christ. So when you think about it, one way to understand this passage is to see that the one thing that this man lacks is Christ Jesus the Lord. But in order for him to get the one thing that he lacks, he is supposed to give up everything that he has. But why? Why is Christ asking this man to give up all his possessions? Well, we need to see that in verse 22. And it's the saddest and yet most illuminating verse in this passage. The Bible says, "Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions." He was disheartened. The word that's used in the original language for disheartened is also shocked, sometimes translated as shocked. And you see, there would be a certain level of shock here. He's shocked and disheartened, not angry or repulsed. He's genuinely sad. Some versions would even say his face fell, meaning that he had a genuine, heart-wrenching, emotional equation in his heart that was visible on his face. So he did take the decision quite seriously, And Mark says, the reason he made this decision is because of his great possessions. So what's going on here? Mark is telling us that when Christ told him what he needs to do, the thing that he lacks, he did a mental calculation. He took a balance in his mind. On the one side, he put all his possessions, his property, his jewels, his cash, or coins, everything that he valued on the one hand. And on the other hand, he put Christ. And it turned out that his possessions were more valuable for him. He had an idol, something that had taken the place of being the most important thing in his life, something that dominated and controlled his thinking, his desires, his time, and his life. He lived for this idol. He served this idol. And he could not imagine his life without this idol. C.S. Lewis said this about the way the human heart works. It would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures, fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in the slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased. Do you want to know how that looks like? It looks like verse 22. It looks like a man choosing his earthly possessions and choosing them over Christ's infinite joy. He chose his great possessions over Christ, his light momentary joys over eternal pleasures in Christ. He chose a villa. This is like choosing a villa in Whitefield over a mansion in heaven. Choosing a BMW over being with Christ, his master. It's choosing brief security and comfort in this life over eternal security and joy in Christ. So we might listen to this, look at this, feel pity for this young man, a rich young ruler, and say, oh, thank God I'm not like him. I don't have those great possessions. John Calvin in the Institutes made a very, very important statement. He said, our hearts are a perpetual idol factory, constantly churning and manufacturing new idols, things that will dominate and control us. For some, it is money and possessions and things, but for others, it could be power, it could be control, it could be comfort or approval of men or something else. We may deny it, we may laugh about it, but functionally, there may be something in our life that controls us. And when we are faced with that ultimate decision, we choose that over Christ. For this man, it was possessions. Did you notice the masterful way in which Christ, the great spiritual surgeon, unveiled and unearthed the idol of this man's heart? Christ dips his spiritual surgical instruments in love, opens up this man's heart to show that the thing that really mattered, the thing that really mattered to him, were his possessions. Did you notice the way Christ showed him, he was covering up his idol with a pious religious life, with keeping the commandments. He was whitewashing his tomb with the commandments. Did you also notice that Christ showed him his faulty vision of Christ? First question he asked was, why do you call me good? And immediately, in the next time he talks to Christ, in verse 20, he says, teacher. Christ didn't tell him, don't call me good. As a matter of fact, Christ calls himself the good shepherd in John. But he's not willing to call Christ good anymore because he doesn't believe that Jesus has anything divine in him. That Jesus is not God. You remember Peter in chapter 8? Faced with the same question of, who do you say I am, Peter? Peter says, you are the Christ. And the same Peter, in this context, just a few minutes after this happens, you see verse 29, I believe, Peter says, Lord, we've left everything for you. Why was Peter able to do it? Because he saw Christ to be who he really is. This is very important. In John chapter 17 and verse 3, Jesus said, and this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. Eternal life is to know Christ. In John 11, 25, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 11, John says, who by the way must have been in this group watching all of this happen with the rich young ruler, years later writes a letter, and this is what he says in 1 John 5, 11. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life. And this is life. And this life is in His Son. Eternal life is Jesus Christ. It's to know Christ. It's to delight in Christ. Unless we truly know Christ, we can never have Christ and be freed from our idols. Can you see the greatness of Christ? Can you see the greatness of Christ today? Jesus is the greatest. Jesus is the greatest treasure. He's the greatest riches. He's the greatest jewel. Jesus is the greatest authority, the greatest power, the greatest ruler, the greatest king, the greatest sovereign. Jesus is the greatest glory, greatest majesty, greatest splendor. He's the greatest lover. He's the greatest companion, the greatest friend, the greatest brother. He's the greatest hope, the greatest anticipation, the greatest expectation. Jesus is the greatest wrath, the greatest fury, the greatest vengeance, the greatest justice, the greatest judge, the greatest compassion, the greatest kindness, the greatest gentleness, the greatest love, the greatest prophet, the greatest priest, the greatest king. He's the greatest pleasure, the greatest happiness, the greatest joy, the greatest redeemer, the greatest deliverer, the greatest savior. He's the greatest counselor, the greatest wisdom, the greatest knowledge. He's the greatest food, the water, the bread, the light, the door, the shepherd, the resurrection. Jesus is the greatest name, the greatest way, the greatest truth, and the greatest life. Jesus is the greatest thought, the greatest idea, the greatest name. There is no other name under heaven given among men, by which we must be saved. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things. And in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything, he might be preeminent. Jesus is the greatest. Here's an individual that just could not see it. He could see the greatness of his possessions, but not the greatness of Christ. Once Christ is our true Lord, our true life, then everything else becomes secondary. We hold everything lightly, loosely. We use everything for Christ and for his mission in this world. This is radical, isn't it? This is difficult. But this is radical, true obedience to Christ. This is the call of Christ. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. May the Lord grant us the grace to follow him this way. As a takeaway, here's a statement. With God's help, shatter the idol of your heart and pursue, follow the one thing that matters, Jesus Christ, your Lord. Shall we pray? And just in silent reflection, would you just spend a moment thinking about what Christ may tell you? Is Christ showing an idol in your life? If you've never followed Christ in your life and you hear the call now and you're willing to deny yourself, take up your cross and follow him, would you make that commitment today? If you're already following Christ, but there is something that Christ shows us as being the idol of our life, would we ask for God's help to shatter that idol and follow Christ as our supreme desire, our utmost value, our pearl of great price, our lovely thing? Dear Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that you do this work of spiritual surgery on all your children, on all the saints of old, the prophets. You've shown them the idols of their heart. And now, Father, would you be merciful and gracious and come and do that work in our hearts as well, that we may shatter the idol of our heart and follow you faithfully as our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the precious name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
So in response to what we have just heard, let's sing this beautiful song, I'd Rather Have Jesus. In the meantime, let's take the opportunity to give to the Lord. You can participate through online giving. All the details are on your screen. Let's sing this song. Silver or gold,
rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or land. Yes, I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to His dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. Yes, I'd rather be true to His holy name than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Look to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank You for the word that we heard this morning, and we praise You because Jesus truly is the great treasure. Help us to see that, realize it, and understand it, and follow Jesus Christ as our true Lord and our true Savior. We thank You for even the offering that was made by Your people, and thank You for generosity and for Your provisions that we are able to give back a small portion for the work of the church, for the extension of the gospel. And we pray that whatever has been collected would be used well for the kingdom of God. And we ask for Your blessings upon us for this week, and help us to have a Christ-centered and a fruitful week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Blessed Christ-centered week. We'll see you all next week again.